Governments here have always supplied the Speaker of Parliament. Not this time. The opposition's Christopher Pyne this week couldn't nominate a single Labor politician willing to accept this great honour.
I nominate the member for Chisholm today.
I do not accept the nomination.
I move that the member for Lyons do take the chair of this House as Speaker.
I decline the nomination.
I move that the member for Braddon do take the chair of this House as Speaker.
I decline the invitation, thank you.
The member for Cunningham, the member for Capricornia, the member for Hindmarsh, the member for Reed, the member for Corwell, the member for Petrie.
I decline the nomination by the member for Stanley.
And so Peter Slipper from the opposition became Speaker, effectively giving Labor his vote. Joining me is former Federal Treasurer Peter Costello and former New South Wales Labor Treasurer Michael Costa. Michael, appointing Peter Slipper, was this a masterstroke by Julia Gillard?
Well, time will tell whether it was a masterstroke, but certainly from a parliamentary tactical point of view, I think it was a good move on the part of the government. The real issue is, how will it play out in the electorate? And I think it'll be a negative in the electorate. But she's got her buffer. The interesting thing here, of course, is that it inadvertently helps Kevin Rudd, because any buffer that Julia Gillard has is a buffer for Kevin Rudd as well.
Well, I just wonder, Peter, whether Julia Gillard has bought insurance she didn't really need. The independents weren't going to vote her out, I would have thought, at a premium she can't afford, this sneakiness thing.
I think one of the things that opens up, of course, is the pokies tax. She now no longer needs Wilkie, so that's a big advantage from her. The downside of all of this is it's a very tawdry deal, extremely tawdry deal, and from now on, Peter Slipper is Julia Gillard's problem. Now,
How big a problem is he from your personal experience?
I was in the Parliament with Peter Slipper and I had to manage him on occasion. He's a problem. His expenses are a problem. Some of his behaviours are a problem. And from now on, that is Julia Gillard's problem. So she's now got to justify his expenses. She's got to get him through the inquiry into his expenses. She's got Craig Thompson on her hands as well. For all of the talk about elevating parliamentary standards, for all of the talk about how a female would bring a new touch to Australian politics, it's a tawdry house and she is implicated in it.
But, Michael, this is what I think is the bottom line, isn't it? I don't see that the independents would ever have forced an election, a Labor to an early election that they would have lost themselves. So I think it would have gone full time. Now she's got this yucky kind of image to go with it.
But she's got a buffer, and the pokies tax was a real issue. The mandatory pre-commitment was a real issue, particularly in New South Wales and Queensland. And if he was true to his word, Wilkie could have brought down the government. The buffer's there.
But Wilkie says, "Oh no, no, they won't burn me. They know that they need me."
Well, I'll be surprised at that. I think anything that comes out of the negotiations is going to be a lot more palatable to those MPs and those marginals in Queensland and New South Wales. The bottom line with this is, it's a good parliamentary move, but I think it's not going to go down well in the electorate at all.
But Andrew, I mean, they don't need Wilkie. That's the whole point of this manoeuvre. They do not need Wilkie anymore. So Wilkie can do whatever he likes. This government will survive now on the votes of the rusted-on Labor supporters who are Oakeshott and Windsor, and on the neutralisation of Peter Slipper's vote. So, look, it's good in that sense. There is an analogy with this. Mel Colston did Absolutely. The same thing when we were in government. And Robert Ray and others in the Labor Party made it their business to kill Mel Colston. And in the process of killing Mel Colston, politically, I should say, they began going through everybody's expenses. That had very, very unpredictable results. A few Liberal ministers were forced out of office and eventually it ended with the Senator Sherry affair. Now, it's only fair in these circumstances that if the Speaker, somebody has been elevated to the Speakership, who is under investigation as we speak, it is only fair now that the microscope be put on him and be put on everybody else in a similar situation, including Craig Thompson. And I predict that the consequence of this will be that there will be an inordinate focus again on ethics. And at the end of the day, it's Julia Gillard who's put this back in the spotlight, and it's Julia Gillard who has to live with it.
But that's where the problem is. If this bloke, according to all the press reports and his colleagues' comments, was abusing expenses for so long and so blatantly, why hasn't it been dealt with in the past? I mean, I don't have actually any problem with the light being turned on MPs' expenses. If they're if they've been abusing them, it ought to be dealt with. The irony, I think, here, and where I think Tony Abbott's wrong in the Liberal Party, is to start focusing on the expenses now because he's ratted, rather than focusing on this issue that was there all along.
Yeah, that's what actually happened with Mel Costin, by the way.
The Coalition was at least belatedly going to sack him. Labor's promoted him. But is Tony Abbott to blame? Some people are saying Tony Abbott should not have let things slide with Peter Slipper to the extent where he would have ratted.
No, I don't think Tony Abbott is to blame. Look, I made the point when you get a parliament where one independent is so critical, everybody has an incentive for personal gain to go independent, right? I mean, Oakeshott Windsor showed how much power you can have. Wilkie showed how much power you can have. Slipper has now shown. I mean, the only thing that amazes me is we haven't had more people going independent. Slipper was always a loose cannon. He was always a loose cannon. And you look back and you say, what could have been done? The only thing I think that could have been done better was that the administration of the LNP in Queensland completely ham-fistedly provoked his exit. I mean, this idea
who
that they were going to...
wants to preserve a guy? This is the thing.
No, no,
he
wants to preserve a guy, Why threaten to expel a guy whose career is coming to an end 2 years before an election?
Because allegedly he's rorting his expenses. He's acting inappropriately, but he should go earlier if he's acting like that.
Hang on, he's under investigation. When we know the outcome of that, the Parliament will deal with him. But hang on, 2 years out from an election, who says we're going to expel you? Let me tell you this. Is the Labor Party running around saying we're going to expel Kevin Rudd?
Isn't the difference? Look, Parliament, has it been adorned by replacing Harry Jenkins with Peter Slipper, or is it a disgrace?
I think it's a disgrace that Peter Slipper was able to survive for so long with all of the alleged problems that he has, independent of him becoming Speaker. I mean, if there was a problem with this bloke, it should have been dealt with. Should have been dealt with by the Coalition.
Should have been dealt with by him to Speaker, in charge of parliamentary standards.
I'm not defending the decision to put him there, but I'm saying the problem predates him becoming Speaker, and it wasn't dealt with.
He should have been cleaned out because he had bad expenses, and because he wasn't, we made him the Speaker.
Look, I don't understand. I think Parliament's been shamed by this, to tell the truth. Can we just go... Overlooked was the fact that the mining tax was finally passed through Parliament in a late-night sitting. Great that we're going to hit the miners for a bit of extra tax.
I think the mining tax, the way it's evolved, has been an unmitigated disaster. Remember, the idea behind all of this was to create a level playing field between manufacturing and mining because of the so-called Dutch disease, and I'm not talking about you here.
Yeah, thank you.
The Dutch disease. And what they've ended up with is a tax that delivers a negative result in the first year, and who knows what the whether the assumptions are robust. I don't think they're spending too much.
How
much is it going to raise? We're looking at the global economy going potentially into another recessionary period, our mining exports under pressure. The revenues aren't there, but the expenses are certainly there. So this could be a major disaster.
But the government, Peter, says that this is to help pay for such wonderful goodies as increasing the compulsory superannuation levy from 9% to 12%, except who's actually paying for that? Have a look at Bill Shorten. I think he put his foot in it this week.
When the Conservatives say that increasing superannuation from 9 to 12 over the next 7 years is a cost on employers, they're lying. It's offset against real wage increases.
Now, I'm struggling to follow the politics of it here. The mining tax was supposed to help pay for the super, but now we're told it's actually coming out of workers' wages.
Poor old Bill, he looked like he was confusing himself, didn't he? Look, when you increase the super guarantee, either the employer will pay it or the employee will pay it. Mostly the employer pays it. This idea that somehow the government pays it was a sneaky little line that was put in to try and justify a new tax. The government won't be paying this. The government is not giving you something in return for the mining tax. Either your employer will give it to you or you will give up wages in order to get it. But this is how tax policy is now conducted. Sneaky little lines that are put out there. And poor old Bill's forgotten the script, and he's come out and said it.
He's been honest.
But if I may say so, where were all the journalists? Where were all the economic journalists whilst all this was going on for the last 3 months? Why weren't they saying the Treasurer is misleading the people?
They were in someone's pocket. That's where they were. Peter Costello and Michael Costa, thank you so much for joining us.
We need a new inquiry into the media.